Public archaeology, which is also called community archaeology, I'm sure that we have already discussed a lot about the definition of public archaeology, but some of these things I find very interesting, is the practice of presenting archaeological data and interpretations of that data to the public. It seeks to engage the interest of members of the public, passing along what archaeologists have learned by way of books, pamphlets, museum displays, lectures, television programs, internet websites, excavation, which are offered to the visitors. I think that in this definition, what is the most interesting thing is the expression, it seeks to engage the interest of members of the public. And this is something, it's not what we offer to the public, but public archaeology's scope is to engage the interest of the public. And this is behind what I'm going to present, and I hope that we may probably have the opportunity to discuss it at the end. So, my interest in public archaeology is a threefold. It has three axes. As I said before, it's the scientific field, it's the science communication to the public field, which is also called, or used to call, scientific literacy 20 years ago. So, and what it is, it's the communication of scientific results. In my case, the communication of archaeological science results, since I'm an archaeological scientist. So, through articles in newspapers, TV documentaries, internet, etc. I'll present some cases, some examples. Another thing that interests me is the trafficking of antiquities and the measures we can take, if not to suppress, at least to restrict or reduce the looting. And my belief is that through training and education, especially the very young population, will eventually succeed in the past taking some measures against trafficking of antiquities. And I will show you some of the activities we have performed so far. And the third interest, my third interest, lies on the everyday life of antiquity and some selected artifacts that are related to the everyday life. And I will present some examples again. So, what is Thetis? Thetis is the name of my company. So, Thetis in Greek is the acronym of the Science and Techniques for Art History Conservation. For the Greek-speaking people, it's the Thetis Epistemes, yet the Technique Historias Ideas. So, Thetis Authentics, which is the current company, it's an entity, was created in 1999, and it took over the activities of the first company that I had created in 1994, following my PhD, and which was exclusively a consulting company offering, focusing on analytical services for the archaeology, art, and conservation. Thetis specializes in non-destructive analytical methods addressing issues of authenticity, provenance of ancient artifacts and works of art, museums and private collections. It is located in the center of Athens, very close to the center, behind the Panathinaik Stadium. Our workshop, this ceramic workshop, is open to the public, so if it happens to be in Athens, you are welcome to come, call or send an email and come and visit us. Our services deal mostly with ancient technology and material culture, and we offer expertise and analysis and reproduction of artifacts. So the in-house facilities include a chemical laboratory for the processing of clay materials, optical microscopy and portable XRF system. I don't know if you are familiar with the XRF systems, analytical systems. Laboratory and production kilns, a ceramic wheel, all associated IT equipment for recording and documentation. And we have access to analytical equipment in major institutions, laboratories and research centers in Greece, but also in abroad. So since 2007, we collaborate with BLIX, is the Berlin Laboratory for Innovative X-ray Applications, which is located at the Technical University of Berlin. But we have also collaborated with the analytical laboratory in the Louvre and other laboratories. So, apart from services, most of the projects that we perform in collaboration with museums, university collections, cultural libraries, foundations, etc., deal focus on the study of ancient and traditional ceramics with a view to document and reproduce them. I must tell you that in the beginning, we were dealing with several materials and several products, but with several ancient artifacts. But over the years, Thetis became a niche expertise in ancient ceramic technology, which is vital in today's marketplace. So in fact, the market led us to what we are doing now. Our motto is research, recovery, and revival in a way to describe what we are doing. This is how we started. We started from pure research. We moved to recovery, which is the experiment, which is tangible to experimental archaeology or laboratory experiments. From this, we went to full-scale reproduction. But apart from copying, apart from reproducing the authentic, the original objects, we now have started moving beyond that. And this is what I call revival. In Greek, analysis, anaptysi, anaviosi, which is the translation of that. And so, research, recovery, revival, the three RE of archaeological artifacts for public exhibitions, private collections, or other educational collections. An example is the is an educational collection that we produced 5-6 years ago for the Massey University in New Zealand. This is a university that doesn't own authentic antiquities, which is very common in some USA archaeology departments. Or even in Greece, for example, there is a university museum, an educational collection with authentic antiquities in the located in the archaeology department in Athens. I'm sure in Thessaloniki you also have one of them. Yesterday we saw a museum. I don't know about the ownership of the collection of the objects, but again, there is a museum which is related. We visited a museum related to the archaeology department of the university here. In such cases, like the Massey University in New Zealand, they didn't have an interesting and high quality collection of authentic objects. So we produced some 35 objects which form the seed for such an educational collection, and we think that in the future we'll go ahead. We also, apart from these objects which are produced on demand, let's say, we also have customized products which are sold in museum shops, the two major museum shops in Athens, the Acropolis Museum and the Benaki Museum. We have also collaborated with other museum shops, but over time we decided to focus on these two museums, dealing with journalists and people who are not do not respect the scientific accuracy, and these are dangers, the over-popularization in some cases. So though the article is well written and it's very accurate, the title was given by the director of the newspaper, so it was completely out of mind. In a collaboration with BBC4, with Alastair Shook, I don't know if you, those based in the UK, may probably know Alastair Shook. See, he was an archaeologist and he holds a PhD in archaeology from the University of Cambridge or Oxford, I don't remember. Anyway, Alastair Shook is a star in BBC television because he produces all these documentaries dealing with antiquity. So in one of these recent documentaries on treasures of ancient Greece, We collaborated with the team, and in the second episode of the classical revolution, they came for the new second for the second episode. They came to our workshop and discussed the two techniques of the vases, the black figure and the red figure technique. And I'm proud to say that it was actually my idea, because the, I have, over the years, through the educational programs, I have seen that even specialized archaeologists in classical archaeology do not really understand the technique behind the black figure and red figure well. And I thought that this might be, instead of talking and talking about several details, it might be interesting to simply talk about the two techniques and show how they were performed and how, after the firing, became red figure and black figure. While before that, the red figure painted, the red figure is the red figure before firing becomes black figure after firing.